the pressure of the jump and the fear and all the things and tasks you have to think about are on your mind. The shape of the ramp he's using requires that the jumper have considerable skill and work with the ramp, interacting with it to produce the desired result. You have to have the speed, you have to have the ramp alignment, you have to interact with the ramp. Here he's going up and he's dragging the rear brake, and that's getting the front end down. He's keeping the front end down, flying level. As you can see, he's as high as a telephone pole. As you can see here, he's in total level flight, and he knows he's long, and he's got a hard impact coming. So he's looking at flat ground, thinking about how he's going to take the impact probably, and overshooting the landing. He's applying power, the rear end's dropping. That's going to make the front end come down softer, which is what he needs to do. When he's in the air, he was waving his right foot around in a circle, counterclockwise, and that was to create more drag in the air. And that drag was there to make him come up shorter, because when he left the launch ramp, he knew he was long, and he was doing what he could to create drag. It takes tremendous strength to resist what it's trying to do to you. And what it's trying to do to you is slap your whole body down onto the top of a motorcycle. It's about like jumping off a telephone pole and landing on top of a motorcycle, feet first, hands first, and just, you know, it'll just crush you into the bike. So Seth exhibited tremendous strength and good technique to minimize injury to himself. When the bike landed, the rear suspension compressed, the front suspension compressed, and the frame stuck in the ground like a cookie cutter. This threw him forward more than he planned. He did not adjust for the wind, and that's just the gamble that each jumper has to make, either adjust or not. But you pay a price either way if something changes against your will.